do not have on your best game today, that's okay. We'll record you and we're going to have a good time. So if you don't want to be recorded before the camera starts,
you're welcome to exit.
But no one here was camera shy. Excellent. So good morning, everyone. Great to see you. We'll get started with the Thursday, August 18th, 2016 Manhattan Borough Board. Wanted to ask if there is a motion to adopt the agenda for today's meeting.
So moved.
So moved is by Anthony Notaro. Second.
Second.
Jim Klein, all in favor? I'll take that as an aye. Any opposed? Abstentions? So passed. Is there a motion to adopt the minutes dated July 21st, 2016? So moved. Is there a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Approved. Thank you all very much. We're waiting for our presenter to come in. So once our presenter is here, we'll sort that out. But one of the exciting things that board members talk about often is being able to share and talk about or give reports and exchange ideas and find out what's happening throughout the borough. So since we have a number of chairs or reps here, why don't we get started with community board reports? So let's start with numero uno, Anthony.
Wow, thank you. We do take August off in terms of meetings. We'll fall a month. But as the new chair there, one of the things, we do have a working group focusing on our organization. I was talking with Jim a couple of moments ago earlier, that we still have a structure which is many decades old and much more geographic oriented. And so our executive committee is looking at that. I did have one question maybe for, I was not able to attend, but I don't know if some of the other chairs reviewed the bylaws meeting that went on, I think last week. And I'd love to hear some more feedback on that. So that's really all I have for this month.
Okay, great. I think we can jump into that a little bit in the borough president's report. Lucille Sondheim was certainly there and engaged. I don't know if anyone else was able to attend. Excellent. Perfect. Great. Thanks, Anthony. So community board
community board two is very interested in seeing the borough president's recommendations on the St. John's Terminal 550 Washington Street project, which is moving through ULURP and is an enormous project in our area with a lot of effects on the nearby area, including Hudson River Park. I mentioned last month we are starting the NYU 2031 project, and there are a lot of effects with a construction project that large adjacent to two other large construction projects. And we are really moving into the summer with these a high volume, as always, of requests for liquor licenses, as I know many other boards share. There's pressure on small businesses, there's pressure on transit, and there's pressure on infrastructure. And this is sadly nothing new, but that's my report.
Thank you. The borough president issued a report yesterday, or comments, and so we'll get you a copy of that to make sure the board has it. The short is the borough president approved conditionally the mechanism to transfer the development rights under the condition that it's capped. And no additional development rights are transferred into community board two as a result of the special Hudson River Park district. But there were a number of issues with the development itself, so it's a conditional denial for the development itself. But it's outlined in a 25-page recommendation.
You just put 10 pages.
We'll get it out to everyone. Certainly. Community Board 3.
Thanks, Mark. My name is Jamie Rogers, Chair of Community Board 3. We also don't meet in August. That doesn't mean that things aren't going on. At a July meeting, we passed our district needs statement for fiscal year 2017. It's on our website. It's a great read if you're going to the beach and something to look at. I think we spoke last time about some major developments going on our waterfront. In what's called the Two Bridges neighborhood. Recently, the Department of City Planning. It passed, they They declined to deem the development sufficient, major redevelopment sufficient to kick it to a ULURP. So instead, they'll be conducting an environmental impact study and statement, which our board is going to be playing a part in. Other than that, nothing major report, but September will be chock full of news, I assure you.
All right. Well, chock full of September. Community Board 4, is anyone here? Yeah.
Hi, I'm Bert Lazarin, first chair, Community Board 4. We consolidate our July and August meetings. We had one during the summer. And our meeting this summer was on the High Line, an invitation from the Friends of Hudson River Park. I mean, Friends of the High Line, I get my friends confused. We had an open meeting on the High Line between 15th and 16th Street, with a covered area, if you're familiar with, the Nabisco building. We did a kind of a participatory budget. We invited people from the community who were there. We had items on the wall to add what they wanted. most of what they put up coincided with what we already had in our community needs from years before. Two big items that we're facing. One is, I'm sure you're all aware of the proposed new Port Authority bus terminal, which would wipe out what is remaining of the southern part of Hell's Kitchen. Most of it had been wiped out in the 1940s when they built the Lincoln Tunnel, but there's still a remaining part, including the church and retail operations along 9th Avenue. We're not very pleased with the selection process. We're not pleased with how it was arrived, how the decision was made to have it in New York, and New Jersey was completely eliminated from any site selection, preemptively, I guess that's the word. We opened up communications with the Port Authority to be included in the design process. We even got a meeting with them for, I think, a week and a half ago. And the electeds decided that it was not going to be a viable meeting, so no one attended the meeting with the Port Authority. That's where it's at now. The other big issue that we have with in our district is demolition, process of demolition, which we feel in some areas is, if not the word illegal, certainly suspicious of buildings being demolished. And we're waiting for a meeting being arranged by the mayor's community liaison unit and Councilmember Corey Johnson's office with Department of Buildings and City Planning to try to coordinate what the process is, because as you're aware, sometimes one city agency doesn't know what the other city agency is doing, and there's a lack of overall vision and management. That's about where we are, and we're looking forward to the fall with, of course, with us.
That party never ends.
They would like it better, too.
Yes, indeed. Thank you, Bert. Community Board 5.
Hi. Eric Stern, Chair of the Land Use, Housing, and Zoning Committee meeting. Our board as well did not have a meeting this cycle, but there are three things I'd like to go over. One is that over about 2 years ago, Community Board 5 submitted a resolution to the Department of Transportation to look at this concept of safe streets on 5th and 6th Avenues. I believe that boards 4 and boards 2 and the local council members joined in our request that DOT study the feasibility of safer streets, complete streets on these corridors. We've not really heard much beyond the DOT's current initiative to have a parking protected bike lane, I guess on 6th Avenue up to 34th Street, but we've not heard a response on what their thoughts are on the rest of these two avenues. And that's a somewhat of a concern for us, and I think we'd like to hear from DOT on what their thoughts are. Do they think that it's not feasible to do this elsewhere? Or, you know, is this just not a priority for them? I mean, I can tell you so many collisions that I've just personally seen because of sort of the inefficient flow of traffic, because of cyclists and cars and pedestrians sort of going through these intersections. So that's sort of one point our board is sort of interested in knowing, and if CB2 and CB4 are also still interested in this issue, maybe we could even think about coordinating on a joint letter to DOT with our electeds. That's number one. Number two is the East Midtown planning process. Oftentimes the press will refer to this as East Midtown rezoning. Richard and I and Vicky and other folks would like to always think about this as a planning process and not simply a zoning process. And so we've been in discussions with city agencies and with, of course, Borough President and staff on thinking about how to incorporate the recommendations of the steering committee into policy so that it's not just a zoning plan, but it actually involves improvements to the public realm and to the subway system and support for historic resources of the district. And so we're looking forward to working collaboratively with city agencies on that. The third update is regarding this application known as the Adirama Special Permit. I don't know how many of you are familiar with this issue. I know our wonderful Deputy Borough President is very familiar with this. So for those of you who are not familiar, there is a site in the Ladies Mile Historic District where an owner is able to build 40 units of luxury condominiums as of right, and they are seeking height setback and rear yard waivers through the 74711 special permit that would permit them to build at least 20,000 more square feet of residential, which would mean more than 20 units of luxury residential that would be allowed with the special permit that are not allowed absent the special permit. Our board, in closely reading the zoning resolution and looking at the facts of this case, in a near unanimous resolution, argued that this special permit must be denied unless MIH was applied to this site. This is not an issue of discretion, we argued. We argued that the zoning test was actually explicit, that if a special permit allows for more than a certain increment, then the City Planning Commission is obligated to apply the affordable requirements of MIH. The Borough President not only seconded our position here, but after the City Planning Commission voted with three commissioners dissenting from the majority vote, which is somewhat unusual for those of you familiar with some of these applications, the Borough President issued a triple no to really send the message that this is an issue that's not acceptable, an outcome that's not acceptable, and so now the council will be deciding. And this is an issue that does not just have implications for Community Board 5, but really for many of your districts. And the question is whether if a special permit is lifting a height cap or significantly modifying a setback regulation in such a way that an owner can build more than 10 units of housing that otherwise can't be built under existing zoning, is that an increase? Is that a discretionary land use change that allows more housing? The answer is yes. And so I would urge you guys to sort of to think about how to coordinate with the President's office and ours, and the Met Council on Housing, ANHD, Municipal Arts Society, Urban Justice Center. We have 10 organizations that have been involved with this, to think of how we can collectively get a good outcome at the City Council.
Sure. So. Thank you, Eric. And just to add to that, in terms of the triple no and this action, it was going to go to the chairman for a determination on it. But with the Community Board and the Borough President both saying no to this sort of special permit, if the City Planning Commission says yes, the Borough President can force the council to take it up, which is what the Borough President has enacted. It's not been used very often, but it is a power that the Borough President has in coordination with the Community Board, but certainly feel very strongly that MIH should be applied to this project, even though the total allowable floor area isn't increasing, but the residential floor area is increasing. But we definitely disagree with the position of the commission and hope the council stands with the board and the Borough President. Thank you, Eric, for all your work on that.
Thank you.
Community Board 6.
We don't meet in July or August for full board, but we do have committee meetings. They have been going on. One of the things we've been focusing on, and I've actually mentioned this like 3 times here, is construction congestion. And I want to thank Amit Tigani and Ivanka, whose last name I'm sorry I can't pronounce, for doing some work for us. We're doing a series of maps that will identify where these projects are located. We're finding that there's been no coordination in any kind of development in our district. These are totally permitted sites, but they're on top of each other, and that means that the noises increase, traffic congestion increases, and there's no coordination at all. We're trying to demonstrate that that is an intolerable situation for certain neighborhoods. And Amit and Ivanka have come up with some very good things. We're going to be rolling it into, hopefully, if we get one of the urban fellows, we hope to have that person take over that responsibility and keep making it more interactive and vibrant. Maybe it may be a demonstration project, in fact, for other boards to take advantage of. Last month, I established a special committee for the board, and it's on communications and technology. It's a working group, actually. It's not. It kind of crosses between the board function and the district office function, because we're going to be looking at the quality of our communications, the professional standards of our communications, including things as simple as basic as minutes, but also our website and navigation on the website, which is in good shape now but could be improved. And we're also finding that the interest in using the data that's available to us now and some of the training that the Borough President's Office has coordinated has made it quite clear that there's a lot of data out there that we're not taking full advantage of, and this committee will help us identify how to use that on a committee level. So they're going to be looking at both what will help the district office and what particular reports they can generate on behalf of the other committees on the board. And we'll keep you posted on how it's working. I know some boards already have a technology committee of some kind. We may be late to the ball game here, but it's something that we're kind of excited about doing and catching up with. The other little piece of information is we've been evicted. the office building that we're in has turned condo. we're relocating, but that's, you know, it's going to go on forever. But right now, just today, our district manager is looking for space within the same building they're going to put us in some swing space temporarily. And we have office fit plan. I mean, they got a plan for us at a new location. We hope to be moving to 3rd Avenue between 39th and 40th, which would put us near Grand Central and the very heart of our district. So we're looking forward to the move, but it's just between now and March or April, we're going to be kind of
stressed.
Yeah. Well, just as if we didn't need any more stress. We have had a really rough year. And I think Eric is going to be East Midtown planning opportunity that we have. And I've been new to that one as well. People have been working on it for a number of years now, but I wasn't really directly involved, and I've been very impressed with the work that the steering committee did. And now that they've got all the other agencies involved, we just have to make sure that we have the community goals met, particularly with things like the public realm improvements that are part of that plan. And sometime I'd like us to look at kind of a big issue that's coming up for us is just where community boards fit in a government organization. Because we're constantly running into the problem of being treated as individual agencies in some circumstances and some sort of adjunct to the Borough President's Office in other circumstances. In our case, it comes up particularly when we have only 2 people in the office right now, and we have the imposition of a lot of rules that apply to agencies that would be hundreds of people, and it doesn't work for us. So at some point, no particular time frame, it would be nice to have some kind of conversation whether, even if it requires a charter revision, whether the community boards should take some kind of position on getting our roles to be better clarified. That's just that's not a board position, that's my position. So I'd that's it. Thank you.
Thank you, Rick. And I think it's a worthwhile discussion in terms of the function and operation of a community board, limited with two or three individuals, and then I think some of the broader stuff fitting into government and the treatment of community boards and the
including things like how much time we're given to respond to, you know, well, you were just pretty sacrosanct, but when an agency gives us 30 days to respond, that's impossible.
Right.
Absolutely impossible. I mean, so,
yeah.
That kind of thing is over.
Sure. And it's there's been a lot going on in CB6 in the past year, so
yes.
Congratulations for keeping it together. You've done a fantastic job.
9 months, and I'm still a new kid.
When I was on the board, I lost all my hair.
My turn. Right.
Thank you. CB7.
Sure. Hi, everyone. Is the fact that we're doing it, I'm sorry that I'm a few minutes late. This is the first time we've done our reports this early in the 3 years that I've been chair. So I'm actually super excited about that. It's the one thing that I have advocated. When I leave the board in another 2 months, I think it would be amazing if somehow the borough board could actually alternate or do something where the reports from the community board chairs comes earlier in the meeting rather than later. For a lot of us who have to work and other things, it's a great way to summarize what we're all up to. So happy that it's 9 o'clock and we're able to deliver a report. So thanks for the suggestion.
Thank you.
So we have a lot going on in Community Board 7. We had a big meeting last night related to the Riverside Center, which many of you have heard about. The mayor announced last week that there's going to be advanced construction on the public school that is going in there. We've had a lot of issues related to school equity that we have been addressing on the board through our Youth Education and Libraries Committee. The meeting last night was dealing with the affordable housing piece that's gonna be at Riverside Center. And I actually was late this morning because I had to meet with a constituent for breakfast to discuss sort of the outcome of that meeting. I think some of the other things that are going on in the neighborhood heading into the fall are a review of the Amsterdam Avenue bike lane, which many of you, actually I think most of you, I'm an unfamiliar face to a lot of you because you're new chairs and I've been on the board for the chair for almost 3 years now. But one of the big things that I worked on during my tenure was the construction and sort of the review of the Amsterdam Avenue bike lane, which was supported by Community Board 7 and has been met with a lot of review over the last 3-4 months since it's actually been installed. So that will be another thing for discussion, and the chair who follows me will be working closely with that. And then the final thing is we are working very closely with our neighbors in the community on the proposed expansion of the Museum of Natural History, which is something that I think many of you have also heard about. It's an interesting issue, and I think, Richard, the items you brought up about sort of understanding what the community board's powers are in certain areas is really important to for us as we're thinking about this as well. We have a big meeting coming up in the early fall that is really looking only at the preservation piece. The museum is being constructed on public parkland. For those of you who have visited the Museum of Natural History, it is part of the reconstruction is going to be taking place on Theodore Roosevelt Park, which is a public park. But the vote that is being taken, which you know, there's a lot of community sort of uproar about the construction itself, but the vote that's being taken is really specific to the landmarking piece, given that the museum is a landmark. So we're trying to figure out communications-wise how we communicate to the public that the vote that's being taken is not a vote, do you support or do you not support this museum expansion? It's a vote on the appropriateness of the design, which is a very different thing. There will be DEIS comment periods later into the fall where we will be involved. And that will be really the opportunity for the broader public to weigh in on the other concerns that they have. So there's a lot of like the community board powers and how we, what we're limited in terms of some of these review processes. But so those are, I think, the three big things that we're working on right now. But you know, obviously, I'm excited for the fall. I'm really excited that we have three of our board members who are here. We have one of our vice chairs, Audrey, our co-chair of the Housing Committee, Polly Spain, who may have been at the meeting last night.
Yes.
So I don't know if you have any comments on how the meeting went or want to
Well, the meeting was very productive. We were able to secure information from the developers and the attorneys who were there in regards to affordable housing piece. Basically, that's what we were concerned about. And some of the issues that were raised, obviously, were to make sure that the affordable housing units were adequate and that there were no issues regarding poor doors or anything like that. So we were pleased with that. We are going to discuss it at our next meeting. We have a full board meeting.
Day after Labor Day, it's gonna be really fun for everyone. For those we work around.
Exactly.
Thank you, Polly. And then Susan Schwartz, who is a new member, is also here. Oh, yeah.
Can I add something? Something came up at the meeting last night that I think is a citywide issue. There were some neighbors who were very upset about a religious institution basically selling its property to a developer that could then rebuild religious institution on the ground floor with a tower on top.
Yeah,
and
so Audrey, was that actually voted on last night or was
no,
that just brought up? So maybe
just,
we should table that for another.
I just wanted to say it's
uh-huh.
a broader issue of concern to the community
sure.
about these religious institutions that are having financial problems and how one deals with the whole issue. A plan, whether it's a trust or something, because there are abandoned religious institutions because there's no congregation or congregations that have beautiful buildings that can't support them anymore. And sometimes when you say, well, there can be another use for this beautiful building, I don't necessarily think that it's that easy to take a former church synagogue and turn it into a school or a health facility or whatever. So it's just a general issue that
sure, and I think that will come up eventually. It was not voted on last
night. No,
not at all. Thank you very much, and we'll certainly pay attention to that issue, and also looking at non-religious nonprofit organizations that might do the same. Community Board 8.
Good morning, everybody. My name is Jim Kleins. I'm chair of Community Board 8. And there's just one issue that's been brewing, and it concerns the most eastern side of the district. It's called the East 81st Street Bridge, which carries people over the FDR Drive. And there's three city agencies involved, Department of Design and Construction, Department of Parks, and Department of Transportation. And all of a sudden it was discovered that the work has stopped on the bridge, and neighbors are very concerned, and we can't seem to get a straight answer from any of the city agencies as to why it stopped, or who really has the ultimate jurisdiction over the bridge. And we do have a committee, we have our own transportation committee, we also have our own parks and recreation committee, and there's concern there over which committee will hear it. So I'm gonna have a forum on September 14th, and I've invited all the city agencies to appear, and we will just find out and we'll get to the bottom of it as to who's in charge for this project and what we can do to speed things along. And that's it.
What's the time and location?
The Blood Center,
mm-hmm.
East 67th Street,
yep.
between 1st and 2nd. That's Wednesday, September 14th at 6:30.
Thank you.
Blood Center on East 67th?
Right.
Great, thanks, Jim. Community Board 9?
Just in time. I apologize for being late. We have two issues that are brewing. One is, I think I talked about this last month, we have a DOT parking meters issue about maybe 20 blocks in Harlem. I don't know if you guys are aware of this. Parking meters just kind of popped up without a lot of community input. And so that brings up two issues. One is, what is the definition of community input, and how does the DOT work with us to sort of deal with sort of some of these quality of life issues? And then the second issue is, you know, sort of what role does the community board play, right? So we have a number of different groups. We have some of the restaurants. They have a group called the Frank Douglass Boulevard Alliance. We have a number of different block associations. We have HDFCs. We have a number of groups. Mostly saying, you know, we have concerns about the fact that these meters are here and how they came here and what role did the city councilwoman and the community board play in this. which was minimal. So we got to deal with the fact that the DOT sometimes, I'm assuming this happens in other community boards too, makes decisions unilaterally, and then but they send you a letter maybe a week before they do it and say they gave you input. I mean, they gave you a heads up, but that's not really a heads up, right? So we had a meeting of a number of interested parties last 2 weeks ago. We're going to have in our September transportation meeting, we're going to sort of get a lot of groups together, churches, number of entities together, and talk about what people care about the most. Is it just the meters? Is it, you know, the timing of the meters? Some churches say, you know, when you have 1 hour meters and they have Wednesday night service, people can't come to church. And so we've got a range of things that we're trying to deal with on that front. And so we're hoping by October we can probably have a sit down or a town hall hearing with DOT and talk about the actual issue, but then also talk about this conversation around community input in the process and what things, you know, do they requires a public hearing before they implement it. The second thing is we're actually talking about looking at a 197A plan. I know that's a big hairy issue. It's a lot of work. But we thought we'd start off first with a state of the district report. So we've commissioned a team that's going to focus on this, kind of say, well, what does Community Board 10 look like? What do we have? What do we not have? How does that compare to other community boards? And we're looking, hopefully, to get that done by the end of the year and then see what we try to move forward with in the next year. So exciting times. Sorry I'm late. But, you know, sure, these are issues that you're going to be dealing with also.
Thanks a lot, Brian. Community Board 11.
Yes, good morning. Yes, we did meet in the summertime. We met in July, and that is because we had a ULURP. We had to respond to the ULURP. The ULURP was for Lexington Gardens, which is located 107th Street in Lexington. It's an extension of an existing building that the developer as well as the owner has now added on 350 apartments. Now, this has a colorful history, as you all know. There's always some history associated with development, and no less with Lexington Garden. It started out approximately four years ago, when the owner came to us and they had this vision and they wanted our approval to move forward with giving them disposition. And we said, well, what about your existing properties? Because there was a big issue with the board. Well, of course, we were able to get some victories along the way while he was fine-tuning his vision. And the bottom line is this. He extended for an additional 30 years on affordable housing on his current properties. So that was a great thing, Section 8 for existing properties. Then on top of it, over the time of discussing with him, he began to really hear what we were saying in terms of what the community wanted and what we have actually stated in our East Harlem plan, which of course is local hiring. And that is something that he worked very hard with us, came up with a plan, we approved the plan. Of course, involving local hiring also involves local organizations. That's a gray area. We really have to start looking at that, particularly when they're on the board, because we end up with conflict of interest issues. But for now, the board passed it because this is an important victory for East Harlem. 350 apartments, local hiring, 50-30-20 AMI, where that 50% is affordable housing, with very low, with mixture, obviously, of incomes to achieve that affordability. And most importantly, for me, as an advocate for local hiring, to really, really close that income gap, you must have jobs, and locally. And we all know it's a great thing to work locally, because you don't have the additional cost of transportation, you don't have just the role model for our young people to see some of their people working goes a long way. So that was it. The other thing is that we have put out an ad, and I'm sure you've seen it, we're looking for a part-time community person, liaison in the office, because we know we have a lot on the table. The East Harlem neighborhood planning, the zoning is about to happen, so we know we're going to be very busy, and we know that our current staff is going to be very busy. So if you know anybody, have them apply. It's part-time. And it's at least, I think it's $15, so it's good, right? That's it for me. I want to add something, too, about the church. That is an issue that Harlem in general, because we have a lot of of buildings that are owned by churches that are just giving away their property in view of, well, we'll get a new church with affordable housing. And somehow it turns out the exact opposite. They do get the church, they don't get the funds to build it out. And so there's a dip that, the, of course, the developer gets the affordable housing, but the church doesn't get what they need. So, yes, I believe that's something that maybe as a borough board we should look very closely at as well. That's it.
Thank you very much. Community Board 12.
Hi, good morning. My name is Gerard Dagnall. I'm sitting in for our chair, Shah Ali, of the Community Board 12. We don't meet during July and August, but it has been busy up in Washington Heights and Inwood. We had a big celebration. Borough President had a beautiful reception up at 175th Street at the Palace for the Dominican community. And that was followed by a beautiful event down at the La Marina that rolled into their parade. I think it was in late June, I believe EDC was up in our neighborhood up at Alianza to present about future rezoning on the east side of the number one train, both soft sites. And you know, you may have heard it and seen it on TV, but it's a big issue up in our area as well, the rezoning. There was a development in the Sherman Plaza that you may have heard about as well. The EDC meeting was very well attended by a community that's like very engaged and very on what's going on. And you know, that led into some other meetings after, some watches and some other meetings outside. And you know that our councilmen and borough president worked hard to kind of get 50% affordable, and looked like it was heading in the right direction. But the guarantees, I believe, some things just didn't work out.
Subsidy.
Yeah, you know, it's more than more that.
And how did CB12 vote on the MIH? Because I went back and looked through the vote that we did at Borough Board, and I didn't see that CB12. It was like, I think you voted after we did our vote or something. So
we had a vote in May.
Okay.
It was a yes vote. During that, it was kind of zigged and zagged on it though, because actually during that EDC meeting, there were a lot of representation by community, some board members and other people. Some people felt that they didn't fully understand and they kind of wanted to reconsider, and that's going to be dealt with in September. But you know, people supported affordable housing, mm-hmm. all of us, you know, and things like that. And I guess we'll see. You know, Councilman ended up having a press conference right in front of Sherman Plaza News last week. He obviously stated that he would ultimately not be able to support that. So you know, we go forward. He's going to focus on the larger picture, which is the rezoning of that large area on the other side. That's really the most important stuff. So.
Thank you. Do you have a question?
Yeah, that particular proposal that was actually voted down by the council on that, right?
Yes.
Yeah, unanimously they voted it down.
The community, there was a strong opposition against that development,
mm-hmm.
Which I guess informed the decision, mm-hmm. but it looked like everybody on the other side was working hard to try to make that happen,
mm-hmm.
again,
mm-hmm.
for that 50%.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, my understanding was, I'm not an expert on this, that when you really bring up this, we were talking about permanent affordable,
mm-hmm.
housing.
Mm-hmm.
So it really broke, seemed to break some new ground, which is great.
Well, 20% would be permanently affordable. The other 30% would have been for, I think, 30 years. So it wasn't, 50% wasn't entirely permanent.
Right. And that's what he wanted, but they wanted for all of it. It just didn't work out.
Mm-hmm.
Do you think it will come back?
Sherman Plaza, I'm not sure what goes on with that developer at this point. I'm sure he's disappointed. And
you know, it's privately owned.
Yeah.
Just mm-hmm. for you, you want to ask
that? Yeah, I mean, I think that it may come back. You know, I think the issue is that it's a building that could still be built as of right with
right.
no affordable housing.
Right.
So
right.
that's the, you know, that's always
right.
what you're facing. So, you know, there were some negotiations and there's definitely some controversy about it. I think there was also a lot of misinformation about what was actually happening and what
right.
the sort of deals that were struck in the negotiations with the developer. So for now, there's nothing proposed, but I think something is going to come
right.
back at some point.
I'm sure of it, and as Jessica said, there's an as-of-right opportunity that they have, but I think also one of the things that the community really wanted that they were positively responsive to was the commercial on the ground floor, and so I think from the community board's perspective, you know, the community board may want to see some of those things.
Right.
Yeah, Liz?
So the I know on the news reports have said that this is the first of several potential projects that may get voted down. Are there others? I know they mentioned the Sunnyside project. Are there others in our borough that are subject to that? I know in our neighborhood there's probably not, but in other neighborhoods, are there ones that are facing that same potential?
From the council being voted down by the council, I don't know.
Okay.
Eric?
Well, yeah. The Adirondack special permit, if the council does not feel that they're able to apply, they legally feel that they can apply the requirements of NIH to the special permit to Adirondack, then they may vote that down.
Yeah.
I think the biggest issue with it, particularly when you start talking affordability and to a lower level of AMI, which by the way, AMIs have increased. If you read the papers, it's gone up rather than going down. HUD has issued a new AMI, and I thought it was ridiculous the amount of money they say the average income is for the United States. I think it's 200, somewhere in a crazy 200,000. I'm like, whoa, that doesn't even sound right. But make a long story short, where are they then going to get the subsidies is the big question to get to some of the lower AMI levels that we need.
You know, I think in conversations with HPD, they're looking at it. They're looking at how to provide the additional financing. The complexity with MIH is there are average income bands mm-hmm. that they have to meet, mm-hmm. and as a result of that, there's going to be a blending of different AMIs.
Mm-hmm.
So you can go lower in some cases, but then you would have to go higher,
higher
to meet the
yeah.
average in accordance with MIH. What they are looking at in sort of the case with Sherman Plaza with the additional 30% affordable housing, looking at ways to make that affordable housing affordable in perpetuity rather than a 30-year period, 25-year period. So it's still a work in progress, but it certainly needs advocacy from communities. And I think a lot of the commentary, even from those in the community in Inwood, were talking about the need to address community needs specifically. And so this requires ongoing advocacy from individual communities, and certainly the Borough President's office is here to assist the communities, Lucille and her team, and certainly our land use team.
The only reason why I bring it up to the Borough Board is that AMI plays a very critical role in what is considered affordability and the persistence thereof. And the person or the groups that make that decision is HUD, that's HUD. And I think that as a group, maybe we should start thinking. I don't know about the other boards, how it affects you, but I know it affects us very, very much when it comes to developing affordable housing according to the income levels of your neighborhood. And perhaps we should be thinking about having an advocacy with HUD to really take a look at these HUD levels, these AMI levels, as it relates to neighborhoods, and is there something that we can do to adjust it?
It's true, because I think Westchester County incomes are included
in
right.
New York. That is
correct. Yeah. So I actually, real quick, we actually brought, in Australia Land Use, we brought the HUD representatives to our committee to talk about this issue. And what they said was that at the end of the day, it's a presidential decision, because they have a mandate to do the AMI calculations the way they do now. And they can't do it neighborhood by neighborhood. So they can't say, for example, Upper East Side has one AMI in Harlem and someone else. So any changes to that is really a presidential decision, I mean, which means that, you know, it is what it is. Two more points real quick. Like, on the church issue, we have the same issue in Central Harlem. I mean, we have hundreds of churches that are struggling. And the real issue that they tell you is that they don't have the money to pay their bills.
Yeah.
So, you know, it's either they sell,
mm-hmm.
Which a lot of them do, and cash out, or try to carve one of these deals where they stem the amount of money that they're losing by having someone come in and build a new church for them and then do whatever on top. I mean, unless we have some sort of citywide plan around providing significant resources to churches, this issue will continue. And we can talk about it until we're blue in the face. So.
Thank you. Morris, have you heard from presenters?
The present has pretty much gone AWOL.
AWOL?
All right.
That's what
I'm
wanted to add more.
That means we have no pedestrian improvements, which is
obviously.
I want to apologize to the whole group, but I missed one thing in my report that I do want to bring up and have noted, that CB1 has been working with the Borough President and all elected officials and has a very large task force to look at our coastal resiliency process. And it's a large group and there's lots of issues to deal with, not just funding, but community input, and then design and the effect it would have for other components of the whole city plan. And we're fully committed to this, but I think many people are now getting frustrated in terms of how quickly things are moving, and what results or deliverables we'll see in both the short and long term. So I just wanted to let people know that it's a little off the subject of housing, but we do have to protect what
important.
We have.
Absolutely right. Excellent.
Thanks. Real quick. So the mayor has a 200,000 unit affordable housing plan, right? But nowhere in that plan does it specifically state we need to have X, Y, Z, very low income affordable housing. Right? Mm-hmm. So if you have a number of $200,000 units, you know, middle income housing is cheaper than low income housing. I mean, it's just a fact. And so it's going to be a constant. It's going to be a constant push on to the communities to say, look, we really need a certain level of low income housing, because the natural course of action will skew towards middle income housing because it's just
cheaper
to do.
Doesn't that
hold
to your comments about AMI and what is really low income? Who qualifies for that?
No.
It really is AMI that drives it.
You know, I think there's certainly a lot of discussion about this. Jessica,
part of the mandatory inclusionary housing specifies some of the AMI levels, and I think the way that it's dealt with it is a larger conversation with HUD. But the way it's dealt with is just by percentage. So you say 40% AMI, 20% AMI, so that whatever the AMI is, you get to the income level that you're trying to get to by doing the percentage of AMI.
Right.
And some of that is mandated in the mandatory inclusionary housing text that was passed, but that is not to say at all that it's not an ongoing community issue. And certainly in Sherman Plaza and other places, there's a lot of discussion about what should be higher, should be lower, and those are all negotiations that are like hugely important and that communities really do have to jump into.
Absolutely. Because as AMI change, the percentages are going to reflect different income levels. So, right, exactly. That's the great great visual, Terry. So,
as it gentrifies.
Yeah. Right,
yeah.
Exactly.
It's also 75-25 too, right? So it is the AMIs, but it's the what percentage of market versus affordable.
Right.
And then, so if you have 75-25, which is AMIH, or 70-30, depending on the scenario,
right,
that's not too far from 80-20, which we were screaming and yelling with Bloomberg. So,
yeah.
Not to be controversial at the Borough Board meeting, but that's just the realities of the decisions we're making, and something has to do with how much money does the city want to actually pay to provide affordable housing.
That's it.
Absolutely.
Without
420. Look, I think there's clearly a lot of desire to continue this discussion and really address it and try to figure out ways to address it. So the Borough President's office will talk about it with our colleagues and figure out what some of our next steps are to address the concerns that are coming up. Want to jump into the Borough President's report. One thing I want to do, I want to give certainly I want to give a shout out to everybody for all the work that you do, and certainly shout out to Lucille and Aldrin and Jessica and everyone who's working with community boards. As someone who is a community board, former community board member, I love it. I miss it some days, but I hope one day my hair will grow back. But want to give a special shout out to Gerard, who I think shows up to every single one of our events, and he's in the front of every parade. And so he's really been active, so I just want to say thank you for that. And then I know I asked Lucille if she would, or Anthony brought up the bylaws discussion. Lucille was there, so asked Lucille if she can talk about a couple of next steps. And Jessica, did you have a couple of things? Okay.
So we held our bylaws meeting last Thursday, and I have to say it was a little contentious. I think that sort of our idea around meeting around the bylaws is to really sort of standardize some of the language And Terry was there too, so maybe Terry, you want to talk about a little bit about your perspective. But I think that, you know, each board is so different, and I think this does sort of connect with the role and function and how everything works. I think that each board really has its own very individual sense of what works for their board and what doesn't. And so I think we're really open to hearing from the suggestions of, you know, folks that are representing on whatever bylaws committee you have, to really hear what works for you and what doesn't. I think that there's certain sort of standardized language around election of officers and around sort of board function that I think we would love to see really integrated into the bylaws. But again, depending on what works best for your board, there might be some additions and standard sort of bylaw language that may not work for you all. And so I think sort of our plan is, you know, we have notes from the meeting that we can certainly distribute. And what we do is we sort of update this document every time we meet to sort of reflect a lot of the discussion happening from these meetings. And I hope that, you know, probably in the next couple of months we have another meeting to, again, solicit more feedback and to really sort of finalize this document, because ultimately it really is we want it to be a guiding document for you to be able to update your bylaws as necessary and as needed. So Terry, did you want to?
I thought it was obviously there's charter mandated role, and we all use the words charter mandated as our mantra, and it's good to be reminded of certain things that apply to the community board. I found that very helpful. I also thought it was very interesting, one of the main points that happily we had just in last September revised our bylaws to reflect is the concept but not requirement of having an elections coordinating or committee rather than a nominating, we're going to tell you who we think you should vote for committee. And I thought that I was very pleased to know that that seems to be the direction that that our president's office is sort of encouraging. It's more democratic.
Did the bylaws committee address anything related to absences? Or if there were a standardization across the board, across all boards, about committee absences or full board absences. And I think that's been one of our challenges is we have a great board of 50 members, but sometimes they're not all present all the time.
Mm-hmm.
And it's helpful. We thought that could be something that could be standardized across all the boards, that potentially maybe it wasn't discussed at the meeting, but.
It wasn't discussed, but I think for us, you know, pretty much our position on it is that we would love for the boards to sort of individually handle those type of cases before
okay.
they get to the borough president's office. But, you know, again, if they're members that are not participating and, you know, there's a process for, you know, you've already had discussions with them and sort of have talked to them about their commitment and they're still not sort of honoring that, then, you know, the process would be that the board decides to remove them, and then, you know, if there's an issue with that, obviously you can come to us.
Okay, thanks.
So in terms of the, I think it was a document that came out at that
mm-hmm.
meeting. Can we get a copy of the
Absolutely, absolutely.
Yes.
And secondly, it sounds like your expectation is that we work through that and give you more feedback. So this is a process that will go on for a while.
Absolutely. I mean, we started this last August.
Right.
And
yeah.
So, you know, we knew that this was not going to be like a 3-month process. And, you know, we pretty much have been meeting maybe quarterly to, you know, solicit feedback. And, you know, we know that August is kind of a rough month because people are away on vacation and there are other conflicting meetings. But, you know, our hope is that we have something again in the fall and that more folks can come out. Because, again, the better feedback we get, the better the document will be so that you all will use the actual document.
I spoke to two of our members who did attend it, and their feedback was, in general, it was positive.
Mm-hmm.
And the idea of improving some of ours,
Absolutely.
We know, has to work. But there was a comment about some requirements for taking minutes, even at a committee level.
Mm-hmm.
And that seemed to be maybe a little onerous in terms of, you know, administrative role can capture all this information. Did you get other feedback on that item?
Yeah, I mean, you know, I think part of our desire for that is to have ultimately transparency.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I think ultimately we would love to have every committee meeting's minutes on the website, you know, a day or two after each committee meeting, because, you know, the members of the public are very interested
sure.
in the work that's happening. But again, I think if whatever your structure is for your committees on your board, you all know what works best. You know, the members that you have that can accommodate some of the goals that you have to put that information out. So again, we're this document and sort of the discussion really is supposed to be like for guiding principles, not an absolute, you know.
We didn't have an issue with the principle of it, but maybe just the administration. And you talked about, you know, we have limited staff and
absolutely.
Resources, and it becomes an issue to try and keep up with some of this stuff.
Absolutely.
Can I just, the next meeting, could we have a little bit more advanced notice?
Absolutely.
It was like,
yeah.
I
yeah,
had agreed. On Tuesday,
absolutely.
The meeting was on
yeah.
Thursday.
Yeah, that was
absolutely.
A problem.
And the other one was, it wasn't clear to me who was actually invited.
Yeah.
Because
it said very clearly the executive committee, and
right,
our
executive
bylaws
board.
Person was not an executive board member, and the person who I really wanted in that meeting was our bylaws person.
We need to target who should be.
We said executive committee because, you know, but again, we're thinking of certain boards, you know.
Depends on how.
Exactly.
How
so
how
I think what actually may be helpful, and, you know, maybe Morris can send something, if you can just identify each board, who your bylaws person is, or people are, or committee
okay.
are,
yeah.
then we can just specifically just shoot it out to them. But again, we also really have made this, tried to make this process as transparent as possible, so not just for, you know, bylaws members, but maybe other community board members that really genuinely have an interest in this type of stuff. But, you know, the people that I think representing each board really should be whoever's having their hands in the bylaws themselves.
Right. No, it's fully supported.
Yeah, so for somebody to send any of them to send some of that
yes,
to me?
Yes, we'll send something
right.
out.
We'll do
okay. Well, perfect. Thank you. Jessica, you have something to report?
Sure, just very quickly, we still have yet one more event in August. August 26th, next Friday, is Women's Equality Day. So we're doing an event that is both with women and our youth council, our young leaders of Manhattan have also gotten involved. So we're doing an event. It's a press conference at City Hall at 11 to encourage women and also young people to both register and vote. And then after the press conference, we invite everyone to come to that. It should be a nice, a fun event, a lot of elected officials coming. And then our youth council is going to be doing some voter registration for a few hours after that. So we're all spread out throughout this Lower Manhattan area. So that should be fun. And then fun things after that. But we love everyone to come out and support the Women's Equality Day event on the 26th. And then just very quickly, preview for September. One event we're doing is around driverless cars. I think we've mentioned this before, but it's an interesting area, and it's one of a series that we're hoping to do around some sort of future technology and how it's going to could impact, you know, our borough, given that there are going to be some really big changes coming up, such as potentially driverless cars. The other thing that we're going to be doing in September that have everyone will be involved in, we're going to do some training for CEC, the Community Education Council members. We've done a community board leadership training series, and we'd like to do some training for CEC members as well. But one of the things that we really want to encourage is for CECs and community boards to work together. I know most boards have committees, whether it's an education committee, a youth in education, or social services, everyone calls it something different. But there really is, I think, a need for, especially in some areas, for more coordination, for shared information, shared advocacy in some cases. So we're going to be doing this training, but would also love to involve community board members as well, so that there is more interaction and communication with CECs and community boards.
Right.
And then we also have city council representatives. I don't know if they wanted to give updates.
Oh, sure. Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So just very briefly, our office met with Department of City Planning last week to sort of talk about and preview district statement of needs and kind of talk about borough consultations, which is fast approaching in September. Our office will obviously be there, and one of the things that sort of to support the community board members in sort of the district statement of needs process, the community liaisons are actually going to be taught from OMB how to work the submission process, so that, you know, as you are working on your district statement of needs, if you have any issues, any technical issues with submitting it online, our liaisons, who you all know, will be able to actually help you out in addition to city planning. And I think it's one of the ways in which we can sort of be more helpful during this process. And then obviously we will also be at the borough consultations, and I know that, you know, you will also have folks there as well.
That's great news, because we've had, in our board, we have more board member involvement than most boards do. And some boards just have the district manager take care of it.
Right.
We have a budget and governmental affairs committee that does the whole district needs statement. And it's brilliant. Big advertisement for our committee chair on that one. And actually, I did it before him. So it's
okay.
And three's already got their post. There's posted. Mm-hmm. So, but the help from the borough president's office would be great, because we get into trouble between OMB and city planning and trying to get good responses from the people who attend the consultation. So thank you for getting.
And one of the things that, you know, city planning really talked about was what are the best practices, and they've sort of developed some tools that I'm hoping that they'll be able to make public to you all, sort of including, you know, out of all the boards in Manhattan, which ones sort of have the best submissions for their district statement of needs, and actually what is the best
context.
Exactly. But also, you know, where are all the similarities, you know, out of 11 out of 12 boards, you know, all of the similarities that they had around what are your major issues all had to do with affordable housing.
Right.
And that's all information that I think you all need to be able to see, you know, sort of how across the borough folks are sort of ranking what their issues
mm-hmm.
are. And then also sort of in terms of what is the best practice for submitting it. So some committee, you know, some boards do the committee process, others sort of do rely on one or two people, and it seemed like from city planning, they really appreciated the more sort of collaborative committee process that comes out of doing, as you guys do in CB6. And so, you know, we're hoping that that information that came out of that meeting, that they'll be able to share that with you all. But obviously, we'll be able to help you. I think it'll be really useful that we can help out, you know, during the submission process.
Is that committee a standing committee?
They deal with the budget issues all year round, and they use the district need statement as kind of a tracking device. Are we staying on message as far as getting the things done we said we wanted? You know, if we say we have certain priorities in our district need statement, we should be acting on them during the year.
Right.
So they take that function. The other part of that committee is for any kind of city council move and city council action that doesn't naturally fit into any other standing committee.
Mm-hmm.
It's a miscellaneous committee as well.
Mm-hmm.
But they spend a lot of time on the budget, and they do spend those probably far more time than they should. It's a very time consuming
mm-hmm.
process.
We have a task force that's also meets all year long.
Yeah.
And at all the points in the process, you know, responding to the preliminary budget, to the executive budget, district needs. And it's under the auspices chaired by the second vice chair. It goes on that way. And with the district manager, who's superb, providing his expertise.
Well, I think there's certainly a lot to learn amongst the different boards, so pick up the phone and reach out to each other.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's critical. I do have one thing, additional thing from the borough president, but just to point out, we do have some council member reps. Are there any reports from the council member?
No, I'm just Sean Fitzpatrick from council member Rosenthal's office. Not much report. Looking forward to working with in the fall. And I will say, it was great to have all this time dedicated to the board report.
Hi, Corey from Councilmember Urbanic's office. We have a couple of updates. Something that we're monitoring closely with our friends in Murray Hill is the construction that's going on at the Queens Midtown Tunnel and the backup that has in the evening with lots of honking. So our community liaison has been working closely with some of the co-ops there and the MTA to liaise between them, and we're hoping that it does, it needs to, that it improves, it doesn't get worse, but it might require us to escalate how we approach this for our constituents. Something that we're very pleased about, the council member was pleased when he announced that the litigation over one of Vanderbilt had been resolved, which, as we're talking about, you know, East Midtown and public, the public needs, this will allow the $220 million for subway improvements at Grand Central to move forward. This is great news. And then just two pieces of legislation, which are pretty exciting, that we've been working on. One would be a three strikes rule for taxi drivers. If they have three license suspensions, they would not be able to renew their license to get a new one, which could be great for promoting Vision Zero for people on the streets, but also if you're riding in a cab. And working with some council members in Brooklyn to ensure if there's a public public building that is new or goes has an extensive renovation, that there has to be diaper changing stations in both women's restrooms, men's restrooms, and if a gender neutral or unisex restroom.
Thank you for the updates. The other thing I wanted to mention from the borough president was yesterday, the borough president announced her Manhattan Community Awards program. This is a funding program that the borough president has where she is able to allocate between $3,500 and $5,000 to organizations, to parks for programmatic uses, a concert, a family day, those sorts of things. As a part of it, part of this funding, the borough president is committing $40,000 to the Fresh Taste Manhattan initiative, targeting some food demonstrations in supermarkets, primarily for seniors. So we're hoping that organizations are applying for this funding so that we can help make sure that seniors have access to healthy food and that we're having some food demonstrations. So the application, like I mentioned, was announced yesterday. Applications are open through September 25th. So if you've received the email, please make sure to pass it far and wide. If you have not, please let me know and I'll make sure to get you the information. Terry's on that list. No problem. And I think that's it. You all look wonderful. And may I have a motion to adjourn?
So
move. Is there a second?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Happy Thursday, everyone.
Yeah. On the record, the presenter has gone AWOL.
On the record.
Thank you.
Are you?
I want those committee to appoint one to the national.
I can't do that. Ethnic immigrant community specific outreach community board is a. I'm gonna turn it off.